Well, hello there, my beautiful internet friends, and welcome back to another Saturday story time. You may note that we are not in my normal background. We're not at home. We're sitting in my car, and I hate filming in cars. I feel like it's kind of tacky, but this day did not go according to plan. This week has not gone according to plan, and I did not want to miss telling you guys a Saturday story time. So this week, we're going to be talking about the time that I had to go to the Mayo Clinic, and if you know what the Mayo Clinic is, you'll know that that's a pretty big deal, and I'll talk about what the Mayo Clinic is in just a second for those of you guys who don't know. But in today's story time, we're going to be covering why I had to go there, how I got in, how my experience there actually was versus kind of what it was built up to be, and if I got any answers when I left. So if you don't know, the Mayo Clinic is this kind of giant medical city. It's just a big medical campus in Rochester, Minnesota, and the best of the best of the best work there. People from around the world try to get in to see the doctors at the Mayo Clinic because they are the top of their field. Generally speaking, they won't accept you. They won't review your case unless you've exhausted resources in your area, and that was the case for me. They wouldn't consider my case until I had exhausted doctors in Colorado and like good medical centers here in Colorado. I didn't initially think of going to the Mayo Clinic, but it began to be a real possibility in my mind after about a year of meeting with doctors here in the area and getting absolutely nowhere. So what was actually going on? Well, I know some of you guys know this already, but I had found out in 2013 that I had a Chiari malformation, which is essentially a brain condition where the back of my brain is like compressed against the back of my skull. I was supposed to have brain surgery for that, but they canceled it last minute because they just determined that the risks were going to be way too high for the possible payoff. But that left me with a host of nasty symptoms, with migraines almost every day, being super dizzy, super out of it, super nauseous, just really unable to function as a person. I couldn't work consistently. I couldn't do anything consistently. It was kind of scary to try to go and drive anywhere because I didn't know if I'd just have to like sit and lay down in my car in the parking lot for 2 hours as this condition like encompassed my head and took over my life, and I'd have to wait somewhere until it left, and so I didn't really feel safe going many places. I couldn't work full time for sure, and no one really had any answers because it didn't present itself like other things. Like, I had a lot of migraine-like symptoms, but it wasn't just like migraines. Like, everybody else has migraines. And so after that brain surgery was canceled because they said, I don't think that this is like causing all of your issues. I think there might be something else going on. You should talk to other neurologists. That's what I did. And I talked to other neurologists for a long time here in Colorado. So I talked to a number in the Springs, and then I went up to Denver and we talked to them. And the consensus was essentially like, we don't really know, which was not helpful because I was a young 20-year-old not able to really live life, and I just wasn't satisfied with that. And so I began to consider the Mayo Clinic because people always talked about it. I had had friends who had gone there, and they talked about it kind of like as this medical heaven where everyone could solve your problems. And one of the things that they talked about is that doctors from different specialties would actually talk to each other like the same day about your case, so you wouldn't be bounced from doctor to doctor to doctor waiting weeks at a time for the next appointment. And I was like, yes, that sounds amazing. Get me in there, please. But they only accept kind of complicated cases. I ended up with a primary care doctor who actually used to work with the Mayo Clinic. And eventually, he got me in. They accepted my case. So I was supposed to go there for my first appointment, and then it was kind of an undetermined amount of time that I would be there for. Brian, being the lovely human being that he was, we were not married at that time, and my mom, we all got in my little white Chevy Sonic, which is not a big car for three people, and drove from Colorado to Minnesota in the winter, prepared for I wasn't really sure what. But we didn't know if we were going to be there for like one appointment or like 50. And before we go any further talking about the Mayo Clinic specifically, I want to talk about something that I think really impacts patient care and how I felt as a person and in doctor's offices. So often I would be explaining myself over and over again. I'd have like 3 minutes with a doctor before they were on to something else after waiting like 2 months to get in with this specialist who was super important. And front desk workers have bad days, and so sometimes they wouldn't be nice to me, and like trying to schedule appointments is difficult, and getting doctors to actually listen to you and take you seriously is very challenging, and referral systems are frustrating at times. And so I'd been dealing with that for quite some time, and then I showed up to the Mayo Clinic, and I felt like I was like checking into a 5-star hotel. Now, I wasn't actually like staying in the hospital. We'd rented like an Airbnb nearby, but they treat you like you're a person from the moment you walk in the door. Like, I was handed like a nice packet and like schedule of events, essentially, of like who I was gonna meet with, when I was gonna meet with them, who those people were, how it was gonna be laid out. And even just like that was so refreshing. And then it like all began. So we kind of checked in on day one, and then day two is when I was supposed to start meeting with specifically like the neurologists. And I was understandably super nervous because I just wanted an answer. Like, I just wanted an answer. I just wanted to know what was going on. I wanted something to be better. I wanted to be taken seriously because a lot of doctors didn't really. A lot of doctors would just have more important things to do than listen to me, if that makes sense. And when I got to that first appointment, someone came in who was basically a physician's assistant, and he already knew my case, but he listened to every word I said for honestly about 20 minutes. And did like a bunch of neurological tests and then said, okay, well then I'm gonna bring in the doctor. And she came in and knew my case. She did not ask any of the questions I had already answered to the person before. If you have ever been in a hospital, you know that you answer the same questions like 27 times. She knew why I was there. She knew what we had tried before. She knew what medications I was on. She knew which ones I had tried before. Like, she was on top of things. And that set the tone for the rest of my time at the Mayo Clinic. It was honestly kind of like awe-inspiring when it comes to the medical community. It really blew me away. And like I said, I was really scared for that first appointment, right? And she told me, I think what you're dealing with is vestibular migraines, where essentially you don't get the piercing, horrible pain quite as bad, but you get a lot of vestibular symptoms a lot more than other people do. And I think you're dealing with some kind of dizziness issue on top of that, so I want you to see a couple other colleagues. But while you're here, let's do lots of other stuff too. Because I was also dealing with chronic neck issues and chronic pain issues when it came to that. And so from there, I started seeing other doctors. Now, here's the thing. The Mayo Clinic is booked out for like months, right? But they said if you go to the front desk first thing in the morning and say that, you know, you're here from out of town, as most people are, and you would like to see the doctor, and you sit and you wait, there's a good chance that they'll get you in. And that happened. Every single doctor that they recommended that I get in with, I was able to see by sitting in a waiting room patiently throughout the day and waiting for it to happen. They made time for me. They made time for me, every single one of them. And the initial neurologist that I had seen wanted to see me one time again before I left. So I had like, I think it was just about 10 days that we were there. It may have been a little bit less than that, that I was just talking to doctor after doctor. And you know what? It was one of the most gratifying experiences of my life when it comes to medicine, because every person I talked to listened to me. No one was in a hurry. No one was rushing off to do something else important. Like, I was the important thing. Like, that in itself was a super healing experience, because I had so much experience with doctors who had more important things on their mind than my life that was in shambles. And then I was at this place where people were on board to figure out what the heck was going on, and all the doctors seemed to talk to each other and they knew what was going on. And long story short, that initial diagnosis is the diagnosis that I have. I have a Chiari malformation, I have vestibular migraines, and I have chronic subjective dizziness syndrome, which apparently is a real thing. I just get dizzy a lot. I tip over a lot. I'm just very wobbly. And they were some of the first doctors to ever talk about the fact that some of the relational and emotional trauma that I had gone through might be impacting my physical health, might be impacting like the rest of my body and other areas that I felt pain in, which for the record, they were right about. For the record, that is completely accurate. But other doctors had brought it up like an afterthought, like, oh, maybe you're just dealing with anxiety, you know, like brushing it off. But they took it all very seriously. Like, you know, you have PTSD and that's a serious thing, and that can really impact the conditions that you have, and here's what you should do to take care of that, and here's some suggestions that we have. And they didn't fix anything during those many days that I was at the Mayo Clinic, but it was such a healing experience to go, and I have nothing but good memories, even though I didn't get any answers because of like how I was treated. And how I was treated by every single person I came into contact with, anybody who worked there treated me like that. And I'm sure my experience is not everybody else's experience, but the experience that I had was amazing. It's super frustrating that there wasn't a magic pill that I could take that could fix everything. But doctors who actually listened to me, took their time, and then gave a considered thorough diagnosis after doing a lot of tests and talking to a lot of people was so helpful and so healing. They suggested a number of things that I should try and then like come back. They invited me to like come back after a few months if those things didn't work, but that trip was expensive and so we have not been able to go back to the Mayo Clinic. And also I found doctors that I was able to work with here in the area that were really great too. But a long story short, the Mayo Clinic experience that I had was incredible. And I'm super grateful for it. Even though we didn't get any answers, just being listened to was incredible and different and healing. So today's Saturday story time is, you know, filmed in a car and a little off the cuff and less of a story as an accounting of events, But I did want to share that with you guys because I know a number of you are actually facing going to the Mayo Clinic. I know some of you have actually been to the Mayo Clinic and are at the Mayo Clinic. And so I just wanted to share my experience going there because it was a slightly life-changing one in a good way. A huge shout out to all of my patrons. You guys do so much for me. You keep the lights on, you keep gas in my car, and I really appreciate you. Today's patron of the day is Jody Merkel. Jody, I'm so grateful for all you do for me. Thank you guys for listening. I love you. I'm thinking about you, and I will see you soon. Bye, guys. Hand her from the sky, holding by.